February 2015, a project was started at the Headstone Manor site to change the function of the 16th century Great Tithe Barn. It has been home to the Headstone Manor Heritage Museum since 1986. Joe Saunders, the Heritage and Museum Manager, explains the background to the project.
This is phase one of an overall project to regenerate Headstone Manor and Museum site, which will include the restoration of the Headstone Manor house, the small barn, this building we're standing in now, the granary, and we'll build a new welcome building and cafe at the entrance to the site. But phase one is all about the Great Barn. That is our Grade II listed 16th century building. It's built in 1506. And used to be the home for the entire museum. But what we've done is we've cleared that out, we've put all of the museum in the granary for now, and we're refurbishing it to become a functions and weddings venue. The idea being that that space will then generate ongoing revenue that can support the museum's operation into the future, into the long term.
The contract to carry out the restoration of the Great Barn was let to Langard Limited. Robin Reed, the Langard site manager, discusses the proposed changes to the barn with Joe Saunders. They complete a tour of the site with a walkthrough of the barn interior. Back in Robin's site office, he explains the scope of the project and outlines the work that they will be carrying out.
As project manager, it's an interesting contract because of the nature of the building being a historical site. The overall scheme of the works is to take the roof off, replace approximately 60% of the tiles with new tiles sourced from outside the area. We're going to replace some of the rainy edge boarding on the outside where it's damaged and rotted. Some of the timber framework gets replaced as well, again where it's rotted or split. Inside the building, we're going to take up the old flooring. We then install underfloor heating, which is run from a biomass boiler remote from the site. We then put limestone tiling on top of that. We've got new lighting going in. We've got new toilets going in. The old toilets get taken out and reconfigured into new designs. The kitchen also comes out. We put a new kitchen in. Some of the other smaller rooms around the building, one's been converted to a bar, and the other one is into a reception area with various store areas included as well.
The most significant part of the project is the renovation of the tiled roof. And in preparation for this, scaffolding is erected to gain access to it. As soon as the scaffolding is up, work starts on stripping the roof. Robin now explains the various processes involved in renovating this large tiled roof.
What we're doing here is replacing all the tiles on the roof. There's approximately 65,000 of them in total. We're sorting them as we take them off, keeping the good ones that we're going to reuse. The old ones are getting discarded. We're looking at replacing approximately 40% of the tiles, which have been reclaimed from elsewhere. Our build-up then starts with the strummet board underneath the existing tiles, which stays in place. We've then got the silver insulation membrane goes on top of those battens. We then counter-batten that to keep that in place. We then put the actual felt membrane on top of those counter-battens. Then the tile battens go on, and then in due course we'll be reinstating all the tiles as we go.
Renovation and retiling of the roof proceeds at a pace during March's fine weather. Tyler Darren Cable explains the retiling process.
Basically, the peg nails, 38mm, universal nail. the pegs, the older pegs, sourced from sort of all around, Kent pegs and Surrey pegs, it's a mixture on the roof. These slightly different ones, these are the ones we've sourced in as replacements to use, and they're just mixed in over the whole of the roof. Basically, you've got two holes. One's they're slightly different heights, so you can judge the tile and whatnot. Some of them here have got sort of square holes, which is where they're slightly older tile, and they were used to use wooden pegs, which were square. That's about it, really. Just put a nail in and just hook them over the battens on here. They're all slightly different widths, so you sort of have to juggle it a little bit. If you get a slightly thinner tile, it might go in here, a slightly wider tile, a bit further up.
As work on the roof nears completion, architect Grant Prescott explains some of the issues encountered when restoring a 16th century building.
With any historic building project, there are always the core conservation philosophies of minimum intervention and the retention of as much historic fabric as possible. On buildings such as this, which is Grade 2 style listed, this is not without its challenges, as we need to specifically source these materials in order to create an authentic match and obviously keep this effective in terms of economy as well. What we've had with this building is issues where we've carried out a survey before coming to site and we've found that once we've opened up we've had issues with latent defects and this has had a result of having to replace more material than we originally accounted for. However, with a building of such significance, the key element is to produce the end product. So while we do need to have contingencies to cover the costs of additional issues such as this, we look for a high quality end product, as you can see, is well in progress at the moment.
With the renovation of the roof completed, work starts on the exterior woodwork, with the removal of the shiplap boarding. Many of the lower sections have rotted and are also infested with woodworm. Carpenters Guy Sharman and Keith Brady construct and install new box guttering.
As you can see, we started making the V-box gutter to come along the back of the house here. We routed a nice little groove down here and rebated this piece so that it all goes in. We're going to glue it, well, we've glued and screwed it so far to this bit to give it extra strength. We've left it out in sections like this to stagger the joins to create a more secure fixing, and it's a lot stronger. It's going to be quite a long run, so that's why we've done this in sections. And it's just to make it lighter to get up there and put together. Yep. As you can see, we've got one of the sections up here now. Another reason it's got to be in sections is we've got to put the brackets here to hold the gutter up at different levels to get the right fall so the water runs into the drain pipe. This is one section, as you can see, ready for the next one to go on.
Many of the roof support beams required extensive repairs. Keith Brady illustrates the work involved.
And as you can see, this is the finished article, all glued up, doweled and screwed, maybe occasionally. So this was a lump I've taken out. This, as you can see, it's rotted from the inside. This was deep inside, near enough the centre of the post. And you'd have never have seen that on the inside. See, it just falls away. But that's solid as anything, cemented in, it's good to go.
Whilst the woodwork repairs are ongoing, the next major event on site is the arrival of the biomass boiler. First to come is a 36-ton crane needed to lift in the boiler container. Finally, the 13-metre long biomass boiler container arrives. Navigating the narrow entrance causes some concern before the trailer is in place, ready for the craning. After the delivery of the wood pellet burning biomass boiler and crane in to its final resting place, Joe Saunders explains the reasons for choosing a biomass system.
This is the biomass boiler unit that we are installing to heat all of the buildings on the Headstone Manor site. We've done it in phase one to heat the Great Barn, and in the Great Barn it's going to be heated through underfloor heating, which is the ideal heating solution for a big barn or a warehouse type building, because it only heats the first couple of metres of the air rather than the roof space. And the Great Barn is all roof space. So the first couple of metres are warm, where the people are going to be, and we're not wasting energy by heating the rest of the building. We've gone with biomass because we wanted to find a renewable energy system that could heat all of our buildings. And because of the scheduled ancient monument on the site and the listed building status, we can't have solar panels installed or a ground source heat pump. So this seemed to be the best alternative for us.
Following the delivery of the biomass boiler, work starts on digging the trenches for routing the hot water pipes to the barn. Work proceeds rapidly for the non-heritage part of the site, across the car park and down the access road to the entry gates. Once the trenches have been dug to the required depth, the bottoms are lined with a dry concrete mix. The heavily insulated PVC pipes are now laid in the trenches. Manhandling the coils of pipe proved to be a tricky exercise. The new project manager, Nagin Karsin, together with the architectural team from Lengard, inspect the work carried out by the groundwork subcontractors. As the groundworks commence within the heritage area, the work is overseen by a team from Oxford Archaeology. Mark Gibson explains.
We've been called in to investigate the sites as it is a site of, it's an ancient scheduled monument where the old moated manor and tithe barn are. And we're looking for the remains of any previous buildings that may be damaged by the heating pipeline which is coming through. So we're doing a series of four test pits, each of them down to the depth which is required for the services to be put through. And so far, unfortunately, we have found nothing but 20th century road surfaces and the natural geological clays underneath. So in the hole at currently, there is the natural geological clays at the lowest level, followed by a made ground of crushed brick and stone, then a tarmac, then a bedding layer for a slightly later road, and then the tarmac on top of that. It would be nice to find something in some of the other holes, but so far they don't look that promising.
Following the creation of the test pits, the main trench works proceed, using a combination of hand and mechanical tools. All the works are carefully overseen by members of the Oxford Archaeology team. With the trench works complete, work now starts on the barn interior. The first task is the removal of the old flooring. Once this has been achieved, a new base is constructed prior to installing the underfloor heating pipes. A service duct is created all around the periphery. Installer Chris Byrne describes the various flooring layers.
So what we've got here, we've got polythene membrane to stop any damp coming through, then we've got an insulation, then we've got a protective polythene to protect the insulation, and then on top of that we've got the pipes obviously, then we've got the screed and then a limestone floor going on top of that, and that's the completed job.
The underfloor heating pipework is now installed in a number of separately controlled sections. Chris demonstrates how the pipe is attached to the subfloor.
A little radius on the end of it, put it in a clip again and then clip the end down again. All of these will be 300 centres and that's pretty much how it will all go in.
Once the pipework has been laid, the individual sections are terminated in flow and return manifolds.
As you come down through the hall, each zone will get connected to each one of these, and that will be the flow, and these ones at the bottom are the returns. I think the three thermostats in the building, so you'll have it in three different sections, so maybe there's another manifold around that corner, so you'll probably get half of it on this one, the second half between the two, and then the last section over there, off of a third manifold.
The next stage is to apply a heat-resistant screed to the whole floor. The compound is mixed externally and pumped through to the flooring area. A little manual assistance is sometimes required to get the flow going. Getting the screed flat and level requires some speedy dexterity before the compound sets. With the underfloor heating pipework installed, it's time to get the biomass boiler running. Mark Temple, the commissioning engineer, explains the biomass system and the functioning of its various components.
I'll just introduce what we've got installed here on site. We have a containerised version of a 200 kilowatt cascade boiler installed. That is two 100 kilowatt Biocom Gunsmatic boilers, each rated to produce 100 kilowatts on modulation to a buffer store. From the buffer store, we take the energy and we send it down to the museum and the occupied buildings on demand. The boilers are fed via a bulk fuel store, which is located at the end of the building. It's conveyed via an auger into the day hopper and then consumed in the boiler. What we're looking at now is the fuel store within the container. Onto the rear wall, you're looking at the two inlet pipes where the wood pellets are actually blown in. We then have a hanging black mat which absorbs the energy from the pellets as they're blown in, just to stop them breaking up. If you look downwards, you'll see the two augers that actually convey the wood pellet from the fuel store out into the day hoppers within the boiler room. Okay, we're now observing the rotary assembly in operation. We're conveying wood pellet from the day hopper, which is capacity of 115 kilos, down through the rotary valve, which is two mechanical watermill bucket catchment assemblies, which act as a fire break between the day hopper and the fuel feed mechanism. We're now looking within the combustion chamber of the appliance, and you're looking at the step grate assembly with approximately 150 millimeter pile of wood pellet going through various stages of combustion. As the fuel is expended and the energy is withdrawn, you'll see the darker fuel waste is conveyed down the step grate into the ash bin. Temperature within that combustion chamber when the doors close is 1270 Celsius. We're now looking at the two ash bins. The larger ash bin to the left, that's the receptacle for the ash as it moves down the step grate. There's a rotor auger at the end of the grate and it conveys the ash and deposits it in the bin via the rectangular letterbox slot. To the right hand side is a smaller ash bin that removes the particulate matter from the flue gases and again by auger within the appliance conveys the waste material into the smaller ash bin. We're now looking at the home screen of the Gunsmatic controller. This displays the boiler function mode. If I depress the information button to the bottom right hand side, it will then bring up the boiler operating temperature, the boiler's operating status, and the percentage output demand at the bottom portion of the screen, showing the demand on the boiler at this present moment in time. We're now looking at the heat generation meter, which is where we record the energy being produced by the biomass system, and that information gets passed to Ofgem on a 3-monthly basis.
David Webb shows how the hot water is distributed around the site.
This is the plump room for the biomass boiler. The heat is generated from the biomass boilers in the container next door and is obviously conveyed through here through pipework, which is outside, and then comes into the top of the unit here. It travels down via, this is an isolation valve, obviously just to work on the equipment so you don't have to drain the whole system. This is a strainer which protects the pump from any debris that may be in the system. There shouldn't be once it's all cleaned and up and running. This is the main pump. There are two. The reason there are two is it always there's a run and a standby. The system doesn't need both pumps to run to work, it just needs one. So every time one's running, they automatically change over on a set time scale. It leaves the pumps, carries on down through the pipework below. This is a non-return valve, which just allows the water not to recirculate around itself. Again, another isolation valve, and it continues out and goes out, obviously flow through the bottom of the container, continues underneath through the district pipework to all the areas of the site, which is going to be, at the moment, will be the offices, the main barn, and then there's future provision for later on for the other areas. Obviously, if the water goes out, it has to come back, so it comes back up. This is the return, which comes back from the system. This big silver space age capsule is the expansion vessel. So the water in the system is obviously going to get hot and cold, so this unit takes up the expansion of the water.
Back at the Great Barn, Alan Staples describes the operation of the barn's plant room.
The hot water comes from the main boiler house through the flow, round this pipe, and into the heat exchanger. From the heat exchanger, it goes back round the return, back to the main boiler house. Meanwhile, inside here, the heat from the primary flow and return, those two, is being transferred to the secondary flow and return, which is these two here, which go through the building and feed the radiators and the underfloor heating via this pump. This pump pumps it all the way around the flow, back through the return, and it just keeps circulating round and round. It's all controlled by this control panel here, which should be, once it's set up, will tell you if the building is, if the building doesn't need any heat. This will control the controls on here and turn the heat down all automatically, so there's nothing else to do.
The installation of 370 square metres of limestone flooring is now in progress. Nagin confirms the floor is actually level, but appears to slope due to the angle of the wall beams.
That's plumb now. So it's quite a lot when it gets to the top.
With the tiles in the central area laid, work proceeds with tiling the ducting and the wiring access hatches. Plasterwork on the walls is renovated and decorated. A number of the roof support beams are split, and necessary repairs are carried out by affixing custom-made metal clamps to them. Fitting out of the barn interior proceeds apace, with the installation of radiators and new doors being made and fitted. The extensive plumbing of the pipework for the new toilet block is followed by the construction of new partitions and the addition of contemporary fittings. As the ticket office doors are fitted, Scott describes the alarm and lighting system.
Basically, this here is a panic alarm button because it's the ticket office. If there was an incident that you needed to set off an alarm to basically intruder to set off the police to come over, you'd shove both fingers into that hole there and it'd set off all the alarms. So obviously it's a safety thing for the office. And this one here is your RGB scene setter. So it's all your up down lights, all your red, green, blue lights, the up lights and down lights are all controlled through these scene setting here. You can control them up, down, dim them in, out, change your own colours and everything through them. And over here is where all the controls are for the lighting control system. So basically everything that's been programmed into this via a laptop through the engineers will control dim up, dim down, basically do anything you like with the barn lights. It's all done via a laptop through these little system here. It's like its own little PC. And it's basically got two boxes, because you've got so many lights, so many different actions, so many different things to be done. It's the same system, it's just via two boxes, basically. So you've got these four grey boxes up here as well. They're to do with the extract in the barn. So it's all wired back through the BMS panel, which is over in the plant room. So if it gets to temperature, if it gets too warm, then these will kick in and they will draw the warm air out. As well as the other box on the end there is the ceiling fans. So it'll be auto, it'll be set in auto. So basically if it gets too warm in here, it will draw the hot air up and the extractor fans will be turned on to pull all the warm air out. And in the winter time, once you've got the heating on, the fans will spin the opposite direction and push the warm air down to keep the warm air in the barn for longer than just instead of escaping.
With the building works and snagging finished, project manager Nagin meets with Grant, the architect, to survey and inspect the end result.
It brings up that flooring, don't it?
Yeah.
The fire alarm certificate and the emergency light.
Nagin returns to his office and sums up how the contract has gone.
My last day today, the project went to plan, slightly overran a little bit. The only problem I actually had was working around the toilet areas and the existing beams, forming partitions and all the work around it. The client's very happy and all that leaves is to hand over now. That's it.
The transport arrives to take away the Lane Guard site office. Following handover, the interior of the barn has been transformed for a celebration party arranged by Joe.
So here we are in the finished barn. It's taken just over 9 months to get us here, and we're all set up for our first event this evening. As you can see, the barn is looking absolutely stunning. We're having an event tonight to test out the barn, see how it works, and then we're going to use it as well to thank all the people who've been involved, all the volunteers, the people who've worked in the council to get the money together to make this happen, but also the builders, because they did a pretty good job in the end. And then our first proper event is in a week's time, next Saturday. We have a bride and groom who fell in love with this place a few months ago while we still had builders in it and scaffolding. And they've stuck to their guns, and I'm hoping they are going to be delighted with how it looks now, and that all their guests will be very pleased about how lovely and warm it is in here in November in a barn. But the underfloor heating is doing its job. In fact, I'm a little bit too warm today. It's working a little too hard, but it's looking fantastic, and I think we can really sell this beautiful 500-year-old barn now.